I'm excited to welcome all of you to tonight's special program, a conversation between Chitra Ganesh and scholar Amber Musser. I'm Judy Hecker, director of IPCNY, and we're really happy to team up tonight and co-sponsor this event with the Leslie Lohman Museum of Art. Chitra juried IPCNY's summer exhibition, Give Me Space, as part of our new prints program, and we're grateful for her moving selection and words. And she's busy working on a window commission opening at the Leslie Lohman Museum in October, and we look forward to its unveiling next month. The conversation between Chitra and Amber will be followed by a lively Q&A, so be sure to stick around to the end and also use the Q&A function at any time during the conversation. It'll be moderated. Thanks so much, particularly to Chitra and Amber and to the staff at both institutions for this wonderful collaboration. And I'll turn it over now to Laura from the Leslie Lohman Museum.
Thank you so much, Judy. I'm Laura Rajkovic. I'm the interim director at Leslie Lohman, and I'm so delighted that we're opening our next Queer Power Commission on the windows that wrap around the facade of the museum with the work of artist Chitra Ganesh. It opens October 18th. Come by anytime, day or night, and you can check it out. Chitra is, I'm going to do some brief introductions before we dive in. Chitra's a Brooklyn-based artist whose work I've followed for very many years and I love. She often works with representations of femininity, power, and sexuality, and that are often absent from mainstream discourse. And it's doubly wonderful that she'll share our work for us with us tonight in a conversation with Amber Musser, who is a scholar of American Studies at GW University, at George Washington University, excuse me. As her research focuses on race, sexuality, and aesthetics, I'm certain that what follows is going to be a fascinating conversation and discussion, and I really look forward to hearing all of your questions as well. Thank you so much, Amber and Chitra, and welcome.
All right, so thank you, Laura. This is such an exciting evening. Chitra and I have been in conversation about sort of what we're gonna talk about. So I'm sort of gonna, I guess, lead us off, and then Chitra's gonna share her screen because we have an extensive slideshow ready for you. But one of the things that strikes me about Chitra's work is how many of the images are of women thinking. And so I really wanted us to think explicitly about the idea of femme intelligence and sort of what that might constitute. So Chitra, I don't know if you want to start sharing your screen so we can kind of look at the first image in the slideshow. But yeah, I mean, what I love about this image for me, and I just want you to sort of elaborate on what femme intelligence is for you, but for me, this image really sums it up, right? Because it's sort of, there's a lot of embodied knowledge going on in that image with the hands. I love the way the glitter sort of speaks to sort of this idea of femininity in relation to surface and in relation to pleasure. So yeah, I just thought that would be a nice place for us to kind of kick off thinking about, femme intelligence and knowledge.
Yeah, Amber, I'm everyone, welcome, and thank you guys so much for coming. Amber, I'm super excited to be in conversation with you. I really wanted to thank also the Leslie Lohman Museum and the International Print Center of New York for putting this event together. So I think that in terms of this image, and one of the reasons that I wanted to start with it is that it centers a lot of the things that I think about when I think about opening up the idea of femme. So one of them is reflection and refraction and multiplicity. So this prism, so this, these hands are actually inspired by and drawing on a painting of Newton holding a prism through which a rainbow refracts, like a very famous old art historical painting. So the idea of something that begins as a singular object and then kind of refracts in color and form, but also formlessness, was part of what I was thinking about. another aspect of this image that's important to me is also touch. So this is an image of hands that was painted directly on the wall. The image is about 5 feet. And the material for the gloves is that kind of sequined material that if you touch it, it changes direction. So it's also an invitation for the audience to engage with the work and engage with touch, obviously in a way that would be impossible in our current moment. But I think that the idea of something kind of haptic or sensory or tactility, something that multiplies and doesn't remain as one, and also the process of perception in understanding what femininity, femness are.
I love that. I love that it's sort of remaking of this dominant idea that centers visuality, right, into something that emphasizes all of these different senses, right, and like these different domains of what knowledge can be and sort of like how we can interact with it.
Yeah.
Which is cool. I don't know if you want to go to the next.
Yeah. So one of the things that Amber and I were talking about, and one of the reasons I wanted to show this particular piece is how ideas of time and of language and of memory really work together to create this sort of complexity of what is femme. So for me, a lot of my own work integrates image and text. But it's also thinking about time. And for me, my own understanding of the category of femme, of lived femness, is very much situated in temporality and language. And in regards to how they constitute different queer identities, but also how much and how frequently they change. So one of the things that I was talking about with a close friend of mine, my femme partner in crime, which we talk about often, is how queer generations are sort of truncated and shorter than straight or heteronormative or mainstream generational thinking because language changes so much and so fast. So the ideas around time and perception and text are something that are woven through my work as well.
I think there's also something really interesting about having the, you know, queer femininity in that way, right? Because I think femininity or femness is often looked at as something timeless.
Yeah.
And I think like here, like you talked a lot about playing with like myth, right? And that that is like the sort of temporality of the eternal and juxtaposing that with, I think I was actually having a conversation with a friend of mine last night about queer generations.
You are.
But just sort of thinking about like, you know, like how quickly things change, right? And sort of, so it's, I feel like there's an interesting tension when we're thinking about like feminist and queer feminist in particular that brings together those sorts of juxtapositions. But I think one of the things that we want to, in this moment, right, like we also talked about different moments in the history or a history of queer feminist or femininity more broadly, especially queer femme of color sort of historicity, right? Sort of like what a genealogy of that might look like. And I know you sent me some like amazing images and clips.
Yeah. Some of these I've shared before and some of them I haven't, but I think that for me, trying to assemble some kind of image or images or imagining of what this is was about trying to look in between the cracks of what was happening in terms of representation and visuality. So I'm gonna go through some of my sort of first femme icons that I encountered where I was like, aha, there I see something that I find relatable that feels very different from the environment in which I live, where I feel out of time and out of place as a child of immigrants who brought over a sort of frozen version of their culture, or as a girl who didn't feel exactly like a girl or any of that. So some of those were grounded obviously in like American, like mainstream or media culture, like that image you see of Maria from Sesame Street. And then some of them are actually also very much inspired by Bollywood. These are, and part of that, in terms of this image, there's a way in which this kind of femininity was also connected in immediately to both power and to excess, and also to something very practical and everyday. So I'm just gonna go through these images. And of course, like as somebody who grew up in, you know, the late 70s and early 80s, at a point when there was really not very much representation accessible to children on mainstream television, and there were only like X number of television channels before cable, some of the way my own understanding was woven together included also images from my home context. And all of these images were very different from the kind of way that mainstream media posited brown femininity, which was like something abject and in need of rescue. And you see these ideas actually crossing across racial frameworks. I mean, it happened to feel particularly like poignant and cutting to me with these two images, for example. You see how little has changed in 25 years of how, you know, the category of women in Afghanistan is portrayed and mobilized. So, yeah.
I think it's, I sort of want to go back to that tension between pragmatism and excess that you talk about, because in some ways I actually feel like that is so embedded in the first, you know, the first painting that we talked about of yours with the prism and the hand. But for me, I'm thinking about those things together because I think that that's where I would locate what femme intelligence is, right? And like, especially possibly like a racialized form of intelligence is sort of like oscillating between these two poles. But I'm just sort of curious, like what the pragmatic, I don't know, I'm just sort of interested.
Yeah, well, what the pragmatic aspect of that is, which, I mean, also for me, part of my own like kind of evolution and growth and understanding for myself of queerness, another aspect of that that was very much part of that was getting to understand the domain of sex work and people who do that work, people who support that work, and what that looks like. And I bring that up because I think that the pragmatism is actually a very complicated and very intelligent negotiation of available states and spaces. I mean, you talk a little bit about this in your work, you know, like many people talk, my partner Swati talks about this in her work with sex work, but the idea that there is not this pole between like unfreedom and choice, but that how we negotiate what we present and how we present and how we even make ends meet is part of something that's more complex and structural.
I think what's striking to me, sort of thinking about both these archetypes and the, you know, the femmes in your work, right, is that, and this is, sort of, I guess, sort of veering us towards the queer category, but sort of like that fierceness, right? The sort of intelligence and sort of like, a, you know, it feels like there's a real ability to both assess, you know, figure out what is happening in the broader world, critique it, and then also play with it, right? So there's sort of like a lot of different kinds of negotiations going on. I guess I don't know if you want to, there was a moment when we could talk about WAP and Lucille Bogan. Yeah. I don't know if you want.
We just go through these. So I'll just share these really quickly. So these were sort of some of the very early, like I would even say sort of prepubescent influences or images that stuck in my head. And then I also wanted to say that part of my process for thinking not just about the Windows installation, but my work was also thinking about some formative texts for me and how those constituted what I understood. So these, so like I said, you know, for myself and in terms of just the evolution of how language works, femme for me is very connected to a particular temporality. That temporality is probably when I was coming of age in the mid to late 90s. So I wanted to share some of the texts from that time, whether those were, a lot of them were what we would think of as subculture now, which is also something else we can talk about, what could that mean today. But so these were zines. This is a zine called Bamboo Girl. This was sort of my first, one of my first introductions to kind of understanding that there is a concept of femme. And like what Judy and I were talking about today, which was so interesting, was that looking at this image, it's like there's very little image, but there's so many signifiers. And like the grass of pleasure and leisure and of taking a moment away from something, like there's no faces. There is race, but there's not a wholly racinated subject that's in here. So I think, it's very interesting for me to think about this as a moment for femme or for the constitution of like a femme identity versus some of the places that it's gone to now that it has become untethered, for example, from the word butch. Yeah, so maybe we should talk about WAP now that we're here.
Yes.
We'll go back.
I think, well, I feel like now we have like so many things in the air that we'll come back to queer, because I do want us to spend more time talking explicitly about queerness.
Yeah, yeah.
Not only in relation to femme,
yeah,
but also just sort of as its own formation. But WAP, yeah. So
Amber and I, one of the things Amber and I were talking about was I've been looking at and listening to things that feel really particularly relevant for me as I'm making my Windows project for Leslie Lohman, but also as we were talking. And of course, one of them was WAP, but in addition to WAP, I kind of went down a WAP hole where I was thinking about, because one of the ideas or the thoughts that is recurrent for me in my work is this idea of, despite all of these problematics of illegibility or sort of occlusion, we were always there. So this was always happening, actually, regardless of the language or the terminology that we might want to use. There are certain things that are very persistent, and one of the ancestors of WAP is this song, which we wanted to play a little bit for you right now. So you can listen along and then we'll talk about it. And we'll talk about it in relation to femme.
Nipples on my titties, big as the end of my thumb. I got some between my legs, I'll make a dead man come. Oh, yeah. Baby, won't you shave them dry? No. Want you to grind me, baby, grind me until I cry. Say I fucked all night, all the night before, baby. And I feel just like I want to fuck some more. Great God, Daddy, grind me shave on and shave me back. And when you hear me holler, baby, won't you to shave back? I got nipples on my titties, big in my thumb. That-
okay, so you guys should definitely listen to the rest of that song. It's just as good as the first 52 seconds. But there was something about this, listening to this and thinking about WAP and just trying and understanding that what a lot of us are doing is actually sort of pulling out these moments that have always been there to identify a concurrent arc. Like a concurrent genealogy or arc that has always been there. So,
yeah, I mean, I mean, there's so many, there's so much about WAP to talk. But one of the things that I will say that I, you know, I think for me, one of the threads that I keep sort of bringing out is sort of like where thought is emerging, right? And so one of the things about WAP is not only the centering of, you know, this pleasure and sort of like this demand for pleasure, and also in the in Shave 'Em Dry, but also it's their words are actually very witty, right? So like the pleasure in the lyricism and like the mode of delivery, I find that very pleasing, you know.
Yeah, and even towards the end of the song, like if you listen to the whole thing, she herself can't contain herself from laughing because it just goes into, I mean, she kind of, she meaning the protagonist, she sort of changes roles, changes positions over and over again. Like she talks about domination versus submission. She talks about sex work. She talks about money. She talks about lots of different aspects of this kind of desire and this life, this lived life. You know, so I was thinking about that a lot in terms of even just for us, the moment that we're in politically, there's a lot of coming back full circle. So this song was originally written in 1921, which blows my mind. I mean, I'm also thinking about the election of 1920, the pandemics of 1911 and the anti-Asian racism that goes with them. So there's a lot around time and sort of time feeling less like a straight arrow and maybe more like a spiral or as I was talking about with another friend, like an onion. I mean, there's many different ways that you could think about it, so.
Yeah, well, and I think this also goes back to sort of the cover image of persistent desire, right? Where there's sort of like this, there's the time and then there's also like the moments that sort of, they don't exist outside of time, but they sort of force time to, they force us to experience time in a different way, right?
Right, yeah.
It's sort of like this, the way that pleasure can kind of interrupt both in like extreme ways and also sort of like more mundane. And I think for me, that brings me to thinking about like how you see queerness more broadly. As operating in your work. So, because I think there's obviously like queerness in terms of queer femmes and sort of LGBTQIIA identities, but there's also like a lot of collectivity, right? And like, I mean, the way that we were talking about time itself, you could argue is queer. So I feel like there's lots of different queernesses
operating. Yeah, I think the idea of sort of the lack, there's both an iconicity to what we think about as femme or as queer that's different, obviously, for each thinker and each generation and each moment. So there's that, but at the same time, there's actually a lack of singularity to it. So for me, that idea of thinking about subjectivity or subjecthood is inherently multiple and not multiple as an aberration, as in multiple personalities, but multiple as in multidimensional and very nuanced and also flexible and adaptable depending on the circumstance. So I think that that's part of it too. Am I sharing my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
So I think that for me also, part of that is a part of the idea of feminists and in terms of a larger history or trajectory is also about queering the narrative. And for me, that was related both to the visual language that I sought out in terms of these subcultures, but also my own participation and engagement with feminist and LGBT communities and issues as I was developing my practice, and how those ideas that Amber talked about, like play and humor and joy, and also understanding that there is a larger narrative that I maybe wouldn't necessarily feel like included me or that I fit into, but that there were multiple other concurrent narratives happening. And also, you know, to realize that, like I said before, like we were always there. So for part of my own research for this project, I looked at a lot of archival material around like queer liberation. So here's an image of the first Dyke March. And the thing that I noticed is I kept finding actually like friends and lovers and others, community members in these images, which is quite amazing. So this is an image of the first Dyke March, and the person holding the pride sign is actually like one of my besties, and I was very excited to find her there. One of the things I was thinking about in terms of my own thinking is that I remember for a long time hearing this idea and thinking about this idea that feminism is very white, queerness is very white. And it took me a minute to realize that you might only think that alone if you're grounded in America, but if you have kind of a perspective that moves outside of both America and the Western Hemisphere, there would be no grounds to say that feminism is white or queerness. And so part of my own like engagement with these spaces was also thinking about participating in a queer Asian or a South Asian community as they were forming. I only noticed today that I was in this picture. I actually didn't notice that before, but so these are all like the kinds of events that there were previous pride rallies, pride marches, pride protests, prior to the more commercialization of pride, which is now like 28 hours long with gay policemen, gay firefighters, this, that, you know, like everybody, but Toronto Dominion Bank, like the whole thing is different. But I think that these moments are the ones that I think about as really being important for me, and understanding how our community and our own thinking moves. This is from the first trans march, which I was thinking so fondly of, which I was at in 2005, which was so sweet and so fierce and so strong, but also numerically small compared to the event that happened this June that had 15,000 people at it. I mean, this would have probably had 1,000, you know, at most, maybe a few hundred. So there was a lot of joy. There was a lot of play and imagination. You can see here, there's already like lots of different iterations of femme just floating around in the context. It's just part of the soup. And I think that, so these moments also, like for me, queering the narrative was also about kind of queering the narrative at that time, which was around AIDS or STDs or homophobia, and doing projects within a queer Asian formations that address some of those issues. So like one of those projects was, which I'm going to show a few images of, was it's called Slap, but it was a physical media campaign project where we would create postcards, posters, etc., and pass them out during Pride and have them around. So they included sort of issues of safe sex, but also like a playfulness in the language, thinking about like a larger constellation of issues around queerness, not just about coming out and saying this is who I am, but exotification and appropriation. And then we actually made these print projects in a collective way for a few years at that time. This was a series of posters that we made during Giuliani time. So some of the text down there would give you that information when Rudy Giuliani was the mayor of New York. And those would be wheat pasted around the city. So these kinds of events, these kinds of projects were a way that I really enjoyed and experienced and loved working collectively. And in this case, it's almost becomes literal, like we're creating an alternative genealogy. It's just an actual alternate family tree with images that were collected from the group, and then text that was written by writers, but also lawyers were involved and HIV activists. So these kinds of moments in were very important to me for thinking about how they inform my work, but also my own, expanded my sensibility of like what a queer femininity is. So.
Yeah, no, that's really, thank you for sharing all of that. It's, I mean, I think what's so rich about that version of queerness, right, is like, not only in terms of, you know, moving beyond the singular subject towards collectivity, but also I think it has echoes with our earlier conversation in terms of, you know, who are sort of the ancestors, right, and sort of speaking to this kind of intergenerational version of queerness, right, in that there's both that in the family tree, but I think even just sort of recalling Lucille Bogan, and like the idea of myth, right, just sort of like what kinds of collective, I mean, there's so many different kinds of collectivity that are sort of like all working at once, I think.
Yeah, and I think that for me, those were really important because until I was 16 or so when I went for my first March on Washington, or maybe 15, I had never met another gay person. Like there just, that was not happening at all in my community. So then to go from that to actually experiencing this multiplicity that didn't center the oppression of whiteness onto me, but it was actually something else that was really fun and centering a different part of the world, different aesthetics was really important to me. But I think that, and I think a lot of that, what you see there is also like the pleasure and the joy and thinking about all of these spaces as part of my audience, you know, and not necessarily being like first and foremost in dialogue with art history or the art world, but having these other sorts of spaces of intimacy and of joy where I was able to think about my ideas and connect them to other audiences. So,
yeah, I mean, I think sort of taking a slight detour, I'm curious about kind of the place of comics, right? So if we're thinking about changing the narrative and kind of, you know, queerness more broadly, and also subcultures, right? Like thinking, I'm curious about, like how you see, why you were drawn to comic as a form, how you see yourself working in that genre.
I think that there's something very interesting, which a lot of people talk about in terms of comic, but something about how the absence or the the presence of a non-photographic representation allows for, there's like an abstraction that happens in the figure that allows for different kinds of points of entry and modes of identification. And so for me, in my, when I was very young and looking for those things, a lot of that sensibility I was able to find actually in comics, like Diane DeMassa's Hothead Paisan, Jennifer Camper's Subgirls, and of course, things like Love and Rockets, or other kind of superhero comics of color that would come out every once in a while, and of course, Indian mythological comics. So I think that that's part of that as well. And I also feel like there's a way in which the fracturing within the comic form is actually part of the form, and it allows things to be particulate but whole at the same time, so that you're looking at one and many things at the same time, and that this isn't necessarily something that creates anxiety, but it's actually how you're being led through this particular form as a reader. So I think that for me, that's like an important part of it as well. And I think also like this relationship to the material of childhood and rethinking that or reconfiguring that, reflecting on that differently as a way to construct an alternative teleology or way of being in queerness was something that was important to me. So I think like works that, you know, one of the things that I wanted to talk about, which I'll actually talk about later, but one of the things that stuck with me a lot was thinking about this idea that Felix Gonzalez Torres had talked about in terms of audience and who is your primary audience and how does your audience evolve, and sort of the primary, like the very kernel of one's audience maybe being one's lover and then moving into being friends and community and then like gradually growing in this concentric way, so that you're speaking to a number of different positionalities at the same time, not necessarily just as a marginalized voice who's speaking to power. So that was important for me. And I think that part of that was also about doing things for fun and then how that fun created certain visual languages. So I'll just show some of that now. But I was just thinking about, so it's also about this idea of what's been invisible and ever present at the same time, you know? So so images like this, are you seeing this?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So images like this one or this one are actually like birthday presents that I made for friends and lovers when I was much younger. Thinking about this idea of that, okay, we were always here and we were always this way. And what would that look like if we go back in time with some of the knowledge and ideas that we have now? You know, like these, that were playful and very intimate, but then actually evolved into sort of being part of my visual language and my practice. So this was nice to prepare because these are all, a lot of these are much earlier images, like this is from 2005. And thinking about how these certain markers and signifiers of, like as we talked about, of perception, of intelligence, of femininity became developed in my work through these other non-professional spaces and ways of creating. And then I think this leads right into the comics.
Yeah, I mean, it is great to see sort of like the consistencies and differences between the visual language that you've created, right? Like where the themes are repeating, but sort of like the style of drawing shifts. For whatever, I think, I wouldn't say for whatever reason, for because of the moment that we're in now, when you first showed me these slides of the comics that we can go through, it made me really think about the post-apocalyptic, well, I can't tell if we're in a post-apocalyptic moment or an apocalyptic moment. Yeah, I don't know. I was just sort of struck by the way that the comics, the comic form was able to sort of draw something out about that particular, it's a very particular phenomenology of time that we're in, right? Because it's sort of, things aren't, you know, things are sort of like not really moving in the way that we're used to. And there's something about the comics that are kind of like static.
In this one, you're literally out of time and terrestrial space. You're not even in gravity, you know? So it's like, there's a way that you can actually exit left stage and still have a coherent context when I'm working with comics that, that I find really exciting. And I think also just trying to, like in this image, just trying to give some kind of language or some material for those moments that feel very significant, but don't necessarily have like a clear sort of central point, you know, that you can say, oh, this is illustrating this other idea, or this is deconstructing this hierarchy. It's actually about this interstitial stuff and the shower thoughts and the bathroom thoughts and all the other thoughts that happen where, you know, the information of a change, a trauma, something is being processed.
I think, first I wanna encourage everyone who's watching to go ahead and submit questions in the Q&A. We'll have some conversation to have, but we are definitely really excited to hear from you. So don't worry, it won't just be me asking questions. I mean, I will be asking the questions directly to Chitra, but they will be your questions. So please.
Yeah, we'll need to talk to you, otherwise it's gonna not be so boring.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk to each other on the phone already. Yeah. But picking up on that kind of that idea that these are interior thoughts, I sort of want to start thinking about, you know, the broad, you're doing windows now, right? And sort of that transition from these sort of small interior, internal moments, right, to something that is so big and exterior, right? And you know, I've been thinking a lot about how architecture is its own weird form where you kind of have to, you're walking through or near somebody's externalized vision of their interior thoughts, right? And so it just struck me that, you know, you share so many of these like interior thoughts in these comic forms. I was just wondering if you had any thoughts about, you know, that process of kind of making it both bigger and, you know, something to be like lived in the city that you live in too, you know?
Yeah, I think that, I think there's like a really interesting and amazing sort of negotiation between that the content of it and the form of it, in the sense that one thing that's exciting to me about architecture but also about site-specific work in public is in some ways it operates more like music. I mean, it's something that every time we listen to it and we're in a different mood, it would obviously resonate differently. You know, and same with something that's site-specific, where the weather, the light, what happened that day, what happened politically that day, like all of these things would inform maybe how one perceives parts of it or not. You know, you would end up looking at smaller fragments or maybe the larger thing. But there's a few things about these windows and also the location and all of that that I was thinking about, that That is also really interesting to think about in this moment of the pandemic now, because there's a lot more, as everyone has seen, there's a lot more visible and sort of unattended to homelessness and mental illness. There's a lot more boarded up shops because it's actually cheaper for those corporations to board it up rather than lose money by keeping their stores open. So it's not really about neighborhood community concerns or safety. So all of that stuff was interesting to me. But also like the language of the dominant visual language that you see at this scale, whether it's an image, a window-sized image, or what you see through the window, is advertising. You know, I mean, that's what this orientation is. Like, for example, this image that you're seeing right now is up right now, and it's part of a public art fund project, which is up in a bus shelter. But normally that image that you would see would be some kind of a like an advertisement or a public service announcement. So I guess to look differently at that space and to have others look differently at that space was part of what was interesting to me, you know? And also to think about some of the imagery and language that I've developed at this point during our multiple pandemics. I mean, there's obviously the COVID, there's obviously a racial pandemic. You could further extend that and say there's a pandemic of authoritarianism and censorship. Like there's a lot of sort of fiercely multiplying situations that are like very scary. So I think also to think about how I wanted to use some of this language that you see here in the work and the windows, and thinking about expanding the narratives that we're living with right now for a moment.
That's, yeah, I mean, and for, so I'm glad that you segued right into this one, because I was gonna say, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe that you've said before that the windows are partially inspired by your work on Sultana's Dream.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, so this is a larger series of prints that I did, a suite of 27 prints. It's based on a utopic, feminist utopic science fiction story that was written in 1905, prior to Charlotte Perkin Gilman, Her Land, but very much around the same idea, which is thinking about utopia and critique as inversion. So this is a world, so this is the opening scene, and the opening sentence is, I was lounging around in my bedroom one evening, lazily contemplating the condition of Indian women. So again, it comes back to this idea of like contemplation and rest and thinking and all of these other things. And then the main character, Sultana, gets transported into this kind of futurist feminist utopia, which is collectively governed by women, where knowledge sharing and environmental conservation are at the center of this, of the governance, of the mission, of the aspirations. And it's a process of enlightenment in some ways for her. So part of the interest for me was about this language that I used to flesh out this particular feminist science fiction story, but also the language of graphic art and relief printing in relation to some of its more political dimensions and resonances, which were also very inspiring for me with this work, like thinking about, you know, there's a Bengali artist called Chitra Prasad, who was an amazing printmaker, illustrator, also Elizabeth Catlett and Emery Douglas, others who, Kathy Kolowitz, others who really used this strong graphic knowledge to talk about and think about power, and think about darkness and light, and think about the fact that a body can never really be separated from its context. And that you can see how that gets visualized in the requirement for balance between black and white in these particular images. And so part of this idea of multiplicity was also something that I'm drawing on, and I'll show at the very end, these are other images that were related to my Sultana project, and you can see that even in terms of a singular monument, there is not singularity there, and there can't be singularity. I mean, initially we were trying to cast this as all three sides would be cast from the same mold, but it ended up being nine different molds because of the importance of that. So one thing that these are some of the images that were part of my research for this project. This is Alvin Beltrup. This is from The Persistent Desire. There were also images by Sunil Gupta. And so I wanted to end with a few images, but this particular image, let me stop the share. So that particular image was of a woman by the name of Rita Astor, who was one of the first well-known cases of a trans woman and a black trans woman being murdered. And that happened in 1998. And it sort of, it was a catalyst for the Trans Day of Remembrance. But one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about in this time is what are some of the shadow narratives that are happening during this larger pandemic time and the larger narratives that we see. And definitely one of them was for me the kind of the incessant murder and violence done onto trans and gender nonconforming people of this year. So I wanted to end with just a few of the images that I created for the windows, which are actually, there are hundreds, and so these are just sort of sketches of that, but I wanted to I wanted to share those, and then we can close for discussion. So these are all people who were murdered in 2020. All of them. And I'll just keep going and then say something. Some you may recognize and some you may not. And you can see how important, among other things, the category of femme is to bear on this. And there's one that I actually still haven't completed because it's happening so rapidly. So, but that is very important to me as part of the shadow narrative, and also very important to me in doing this work now. Like I did it, the impulse for that came in part from some of the work I have done around Index of the Disappeared, which is a project that was related to the sort of post 9/11 political climate. And then the thing that's really interesting about this and in relation to femme and feminist is the role and the potency of self-representation in these images. So in other projects where I've done work like this, the images have been scoured also from news media and stuff, but these are, many of these images are images that people put up and were ways that they themselves wanted to be represented on social media. So there's like a living archive of these people still going on their Facebook and Instagram pages. So I think that was also very powerful for me in terms of thinking about self-representation, performance, play, agency, and some of the other things that we talked about. So yeah, I think we should stop and we can take some questions. Thank you guys so much for your time and attention. At least I'm gonna stop. Amber can keep, going.
No, we do have one question so far. So I will ask it, but I do, this is also a reminder to, you know, please go ahead and submit your questions. So the first question we have is from an anonymous attendee who says, I'm really interested in your queering of time in the way that you mix the mythological and a sort of sci-fi or speculative future building that because of the comics feels like a historical sci-fi, if you will. How do you think about these things coming together?
Yeah, so I think a lot about the sort of impetus and the need for mythology and science fiction. I mean, I think they're both ways that humanity has been using to think about these kinds of ontological questions, like who are we? Where did we come from? What is human? What is justice? What is nature? What is extra human, subhuman? How do these things fit into what we think of as humanity and more a moral compass or ethics? How do we create something that's more complex in between good and evil? And then also thinking about how categories that are already in play in a certain social structure. So for example, in India, that would be caste. It would be religion, it would be caste. Here, it would be a racial framework, but how those categories inflect certain representations and how we can use this fantastical framework to think about them differently. So like, for example, I mean, one of the things that I and many people I know loved about Star Trek and loved about Uhura and George Takei is that they were just being, actually. They weren't having a coming of age immigrant drama. They weren't like, they were already there. They were, their subjectivity was embedded in that narrative. And there's a way in which another kind of difference can be embedded within these fantastical realms that I really appreciate. And I think that the same questions that myth is asking, science fiction asks. And I think also for the same reasons that people are feeling, for the same reasons that certain people at certain times didn't want to watch social realist film, because, you know, as my aunt said, why would I want to watch a water tap drip for 30 minutes when I know what water shortage is like? Some people right now don't want to watch science fiction and dystopia, but fantasy functions in the same way. So does like historical drama. I mean, I think there are a lot of spaces where these kinds of larger questions get to have a different form and maybe a more potent form than what we would be able to talk about in our fraught and polarized daily discourse.
And I think related to that, we have a question from Jennifer Finkel who asks, the work that deals specifically with myth, is it a made up myth or rooted in actual mythology?
It's both. Some of them are queering actual myths. I mean, so one of the things, or actual comics, I mean, one of the things that I've talked about before in my work and just in terms of the structure of myth is that there's one of the really important parts of that structure usually is the excision of certain female characters in order for the mythology or the larger narrative to keep moving forward. So for example, I did an installation that was based on Alan Moore's graphic novel, The Watchmen. And in The Watchmen, there's a character called the Silhouette, who's a lesbian who's dyke bashed and murdered because of being a lesbian. Like, she and her lover are murdered in their bed. So she exists in the book only as a murdered character, but she's always on the frames. And so this idea, or you have that in the Ramayana. I mean, you have that in everything. Like, you have that in the Aeneid. I mean, Aeneas loses his wife in a fog. Like, who does that? I mean, who does that? You know, and then that's what, then the next four chapters are about that. Like, Dido just disappears, you know? I mean, it's, so I think this idea of like the disappearance or the like violent erasure of certain kinds of femininity or feminine characters is something that I've been interested in for a long time.
Okay, so we have one from Judy Hecker, who says, since you work in so many media, sculpture, video, installation, in addition to works on paper, what motivates you to pivot from one medium to another?
I think various things, but I think the content of the work, like in terms of Sultana's Dream, it was gonna be sort of a serial project. And I was thinking a lot also about, for example, Franz Masuril and his book of woodcuts called The City, which very much is also, among other things, a critique of class. It has a lot of scenes of poverty, of unemployment, of sex work, of industrialization, of technology. So in that case, it was in relation to that. In terms of the totem I made, it was also in relation to my own sort of experience with statuary and large scale statuary, and also thinking about this particular moment and how it's a moment for monuments and a moment for a fraught conversation around monuments. And it's also a moment where monuments are being deployed in a authoritarian and fascistic way as well. So I think it's really dependent on like the space that the show is in, the ideas behind the work, but it's very much seen like one thread in the work is drawing. Another one is figuration, and another one is language. So I think those are three things that are kind of consistent.
So we have a question from Shruti Shankar, who says, a question I've had that I've been wrestling with myself is how you balance both urgency, the need to make work quickly versus care, thought when making art, particularly in relation to issues of social justice.
So I think that's a great question, and it's really hard. And I was thinking about that a lot during the pandemic. I was also thinking about the pandemic in relation to my own experience as a younger artist of September 11th. At that point, I was like 25, 26, you know, so I was at a different, I was in a different economic bracket. I was in a different stage in my career. I was a different kind of worker than I am now. Like, all of those things informed a very different way that I passed through that moment. But I think that in general, I'm trying to figure out how to respond to things and not react to them. And I think history and research is a really important part of that too, as is speaking with people who have shared interests outside of the domain of contemporary art. So for a lot of the work I did at that time around September 11th, it was also about being in conversation with lawyers and people who were doing other kinds of advocacy work, education, activism, and figuring out a way that you can really get to like the specificity of a situation where even if you're abstracting it visually, some investment in that specificity, whether it's visible or not, will come through to an audience. So it's like the, you know, the devil is in the details, I guess, but like the love is also in the details. So I think it's that. And also some things take a long time. Some things are cooking for like 3-5 many years. And then, you know, so I think there's not a consistent sort of framework, or like, it's not like you can be on cruise control at 60 and then just you make things in a certain order. So I think it's about being flexible with that too.
And so we have another question about the powerful series / archive of portraits of murdered trans people in 2020. These are drafts for the windows, right?
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to be shown?
Black and white, by the way. They're going to be largely monochromatic with a few hints of color, but this is how I did these drawings for myself.
That was basically the question, like where these portraits will be shown.
Okay, so there's two scenes in the windows that are kind of a diptych. There's 10 windows. So there is kind of a panoramic feeling of going across or through a city. And there's also somewhat of a narrative arc between, and a tension and a play between singular and multiple images. So these images are going to be largely in a crowd scene where people are gathering in celebration and protest.
And I think this is just sort of to clarify, where will the window installation be? When will it be installed?
So the window installation will be at the Leslie Lohman Museum, and it's on the corner of Worcester and Grand. It wraps around that corner. It's 12 large windows that are each a different size because of when the building was built. Even the glass on the windows is different. Each one has a different tint based on when it was from. But they're roughly about 60 by 90 inches or 70 by 100 inches each. And other windows in that context that would share that form would be like a store window of a boutique, or maybe a window that was boarded up. But the rest of the architecture that where you would see that kind of windows would be commercial establishments in Soho. And yeah, so for me, it was also about thinking about what it was like to walk through Soho as a kid who grew up in New York. And yeah, there are some aspects of the way that the city has both been gutted and also been resilient from the pandemic that remind me of that as well.
So
we have for many months, and they'll be lit from behind so you can see it 24 hours a day, which is also nice.
It's convenient when people don't necessarily want to be inside.
Yeah, no, you can socially distance and do this. So yeah.
So we have another question. So Chitra, thank you for providing this rich archive of material culture that informs your visual practice. It makes me think of how impactful ephemera is. Can you say more about how impactful the ephemeral nature of display can be in general, but also perhaps more specifically with regards to queer power's temporary window display?
Ephemera was really important for me because, or for many people in a certain generation before information was disseminated online. So ephemera would include like newsletters, club flyers, other things like that. But also I think that the ephemeral nature of this work, I'm also thinking about as something that's about this moment and this time. So that could be about the actual quality of a flyer or of the print culture and how that feels in your hand and how you hold it. But it could also be about this, for me, it's also about this moment where I don't think that this thing of us being outside is gonna end anytime soon, actually. I mean, we do know that this is gonna this is going on for some time without any clear closure. And I think that the idea of this sort of being outside and being both a panorama, but also not being transparent is important to me. Like, I think one of the things you had asked me about before, Amber, was like the window and transparency. And I feel like there's the transparency of the window, but there's also like the what I'm understanding is the viewer's idea of an expectation of transparency or truth, especially when they see like a photographic image of a marginalized subject or of any kind of a documentary subject, like the image becomes a window into the truth. And this is not about that, but about the idea of just opening up, like even what that idea of truth is, or bringing things that are much more playful and not from our material world into that thinking.
There are other questions that people want to submit? Still, I will segue sort of back to something that we, oh, great. Okay, someone anonymous was asking how you think about the combination of the comic book and sci-fi imagery. Is this a combination, perhaps an embodiment of both queerness and possibility slash hope?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it is, just in terms of the form and a way that certain kinds of queerness or sexuality were expressed differently from how you might see them expressed in like a photographic, pornographic, other kind of documentary, other sorts of forms. And yeah, I think it's a way of having like another kind of language or to talk about what's happening right now and how, what kinds of formations are happening, social, queer, or otherwise. And it's also a way for me to bring it out of like a sort of a personalized confessional truth-telling space necessarily. Like, and just question what that is.
While we wait for other questions, I'm gonna take up something that we'd emailed about, but we didn't actually get to. I was gonna talk about sci-fi. We'd talked about, I had mentioned The City We Became, which I was reading in this, partially because it feels like a lot of the ways that you're talking about your relationship to New York specifically, and sort of, again, the different pandemics that have happened and sort of what kinds of possibilities for hope arise from it. And you had mentioned Marlon James's Black Leopard,
Red Wolf, yeah.
And so which I think actually circles back to the first question around, you know, where does the relationship between mythology and sci-fi, and also where does mythology come from? Mm-hmm. But it could just be fun to talk about your literary interests.
Yeah. So I think, like I was talking about books that are related to a city and a shadow city. So Franz Musserl's The City, N.K. Jemisin's city book, the Melville City and the City. There's a lot of books where, you can say this about any big city, but there's not just one New York, there's thousands of New Yorks, you know, and some of them actually never even coincide. You may inhabit one or another depending on your work, your vocation, your economic background, your migration pattern to the city. But just thinking about that there's actually multiple cities happening at the same time. I think the other thing that I really enjoyed about Black Leopard, Red Wolf was just the there was like a specificity in his research about certain kinds of folktales and gathering the information, but that wasn't, those references weren't necessarily what the narrative was about or what you needed to know. And I think also the sort of shape-shiftingness of the characters is also something that I'm really interested in my own work. Like the protagonist is often a character that you might like encounter in a dream where she was like ringing your shit up at the supermarket, but then she was also your mother. And then like in another scene, she was someone else, but it somehow feels like they're the same character. So I think that this kind of permeability of like the interior of the character and also the characteristics, like the more the ones that the world would apprehend. I think that interminglingness is something that I find exciting, that is already structurally in place in mythology and science fiction. Like it's not like you have to be half this and half that. Like the hybridity is just, it's embedded into, you know, it's like melted into the box.
No, it's, I mean, so sort of, this is an awkward segue, but speaking of research and hybridity, so IPCNY's current exhibition, Give Me Space, is a great selection of new prints. Can you talk a little bit about your experience during the COVID-19 moment when the work was largely made before we went into quarantine? So how did the theme emerge? Was there something that most surprised you about looking through the work?
It was an amazing experience to jury the work. I think that one continuity, which is something that has been oft discussed by myself and many people, is that there's many aspects of being an artist that are not that dissimilar from living in COVID. Like, for example, the social isolation or working alone or waking up every day and not knowing exactly what you're going to do. Or thinking about some of the issues around space, around touch, around intimacy in a different way from how they're presented, and looking and thinking about those in relation to how some of our own physical interactions and engagement, and also how the architecture around us has been radically delimited by the pandemic. But I think that, you know, like the pandemic and like many things, I mean, and like a lot of the work in the show, like the story of the pandemic is also a story of power, you know, and it's also about what wasn't working before. And I mean, I was thinking that when I was in Penn Station the other day, like looking around New York City, it feels kind of like there's a grief about the fact that a relationship has ended, but deeper down, you know that there was something wrong with the relationship for actually a couple of years before it ended. And like, so the end of it isn't actually the moment, you know, the moment was the thinking that led to the thinking and the actions that led to this place. And I felt very similarly about the work. Like there was a lot of, I was very excited that in the air, in terms of what people are thinking about, there's a lot of focus on environmental justice and all of the subterranean elements of that, of physical contact, of how queerness gets embodied or pushed out of certain architectural spaces. And I thought that it was also interesting to think about how are you going to select works for an exhibition that is such a, I mean, all art needs to be viewed in person in some way or have that physical capacity, even if you're sitting in a certain screening room or whatever, but like, what does it mean to only get to see these works online in a medium like printmaking that's so laden with the rich materiality and material histories, whether you're talking about the paper or the ink or the surface or how it touches the surface. You know, I mean, you could say similar things about other media as well, like ceramics or sculpture in the round. But that was challenging. And the works are amazing, so you guys should definitely look at them. And I think also it was interesting that there was such a sort of international group of submissions. And I think there is this aspect of now that more people can submit to things or attend things regardless of, for example, disability or location in a way that we weren't able to prior. So,
So we have two last questions. I'll sort of combine them so you can decide how much you want to answer, because we're running out of time. So one of them says, your visual language has become very iconic and recognizable over time, grotesque and somehow wonderful. Representations of bodies, orifices, dismemberment, and floating eyes and other organs. How is this language of bodies with and without the agency of organs functioning across different subject matter and specific contexts? So that's one. And then the last one is, given your interest in the literary and sort of so many different things, right? Question is, did you always want to be an artist? You have such a great wide range of interests and references.
I'll start with the second one and then I'll go back into the first one. But no, I didn't always want to be an artist because I didn't know you could be an artist. And I don't even think I knew what an artist was. Like, I think that if I had known actually that I could have worked in commercial fine art or commercial art, I often wonder if I would have ended up actually like designing album covers or t-shirts or doing something else that was oriented in craft making and design, but not art. So I think that happened over time, but I feel like art and drawing specifically are very capacious. And so they can include, and installation as well. I mean, it can include everything. So my interest in text, my interest in music, my interest in history are all things that feed my work and get fed by my art. But no, I didn't know any artists growing up, except for my art teachers. And I had two Sunday painting uncles. And they were art artists in the community. And the second question was about the conversation around orifices and organs. I think that changes. I think that there are some, like, there's some visual consistencies that where, you know, for example, the eyes or the hands, there's a lot about visuality and points of contact, other ways of seeing. But I think that it depends on the kind of work I'm doing and what the topic is and what the subject matter is. So like a very stark example of that would be, for example, like our work for Index of the Disappeared, where we, Mariam Ghani and I created this archive around post 9/11 disappearances and deportations. The kinds of representations that we chose to pursue and develop were often not the ones that were being propagated by mainstream media. So for example, we did an installation in 2008, which was around US military torture in prisons, but we did not show the orifices and entrails of the Abu Ghraib photos because we did not think that that it was appropriate. So even within this sort of larger framework of a jungly, like an impropriety, there are still really specific negotiations that I'm making. Like for example, a decision not to work with specific Hindu mythological forms, and also a decision to move away from those and think about other signifiers that I have always been interested in because of how that imagery is being appropriated and mobilized for violence by the current Indian government and by Hindutvavadi politics.
That was really great.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for your attention, Amber. That was awesome. Thank you. And thank you so much, interpreters. You guys were amazing. And this was really fun. Please come. So the windows, October 18th, they'll be up. They'll be up for a good long while. There's a lot of information there, so there'll be a way to access that information, the archival information and the research information, as you're looking at the windows. So stay tuned for that. And please visit Give Me Space, which is a beautiful exhibition. And I love the works, and it's been really nice to sort of see some of those artists or get to know their work even further on social media over the course of the show. So thank you guys all so much.
Chitra, you did my job for me. Thank you so
much. Oh, is that what you were doing? Okay, great.
It's great. Amber and Chitra, thank you both for such a, you know, a really nuanced, thoughtful, well-researched and presented conversation. And for everyone out there, we have recorded this. So for those of you who couldn't stay the whole time or came late or want to share it with friends and colleagues, check back at ipcny.org. LeslieLohman.org will get the recording up there in the coming days. And as Chitra said, October 18th, down at Worcester and Grand, the best way to see art these days. And thank you for being such a great collaborator on new prints. Our next new prints exhibition, which opens in the winter, is open now for submissions. So you have an opportunity, artists out there, to submit. The Juror is the collective Black Women of Print, and we're really
amazing
to collaborate with them. So
you're awesome. Yeah.
So we go from Give Me Space to a fall curated show, and then back to new prints with Black Women of Print. So thank you. It was amazing to see the arc from Star Trek and those early March photographs from earlier in your life to, you know, to see how far we've gone today, yet with those incredibly devastating and beautiful drawings of murdered trans people in 2020, how far we have yet to go. So both of you keep working, writing, publishing, and making, and stay tuned, everyone out there, for more programming from our two organizations. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.